Okay, I want to introduce something we called model templates now as a working title. So, yesterday you have seen a lot of basic and resolve tutorials, how you write define variational formulations. People from the math side were very happy to find what they know, how to write down a variational formulation. Maybe people from application on the engineering side think, okay, so it's, I don't want to go that deep into the mathematical formulation. And this model template is a kind of response on this, that you have the possibility to go down as deep as you want, but you can use it also on a higher level. You say you want to do an elasticity or an Navier-Stokes problem. So this is one layer on top of ng-solve. Use the ng-solve and it's a small package, packing together a state-of-the-art definition how we want to do elasticity, how we want to do Navier-Stokes. So it's an own Git project we just pushed this morning. If you download the presentation here called Introduction, you find a link where to how to download it from GitLab, and you can immediately try it. We say later, okay, yeah. So it ought to be something you can use together with some more higher level algorithm, maybe to use it together with optimization or model order reduction, or something what people are doing. And I have to warn, it's very much work in progress. It's just an .1 release, and it's open for discussion and open for trying it out and getting feedback whether it's useful. But I hope. There was a situation for a long time we had the C++ code, and it could do a lot. It was very powerful a lot, but it was very much for insiders, and people had to spend a long time to get into it. And if you wanted to exchange IDs, someone had added this one, a new, then like type one space, then it was put in the C++ code, changing makefile, having a lot of if devs, in particular with Sabine. And exchange it, then had to rebuild, reconfigure everything. I think a major step ahead was in 2015, where we started with the Python frontend, as you have seen yesterday, as we do now. It's just one C++ code, you install it, and from the Python, you say what you want to do it with one code. Maybe some extension, some C++ extension. If you write a nonlinear elasticity solver in C++, it took quite some lines. In Python, it's 5 to 10 times shorter. It's much more expressive. In particular, if I got C++ code from someone, please have a look where is the error. It was much more complicated on finding and debugging the C++ code. With Python, the Python formulation is now much more expressive. You see what, you read the variational formulation, if the code behind has not too many errors anymore, then you see what you get and you find much easier mistakes in the formulation and it's much easier to understand what the formulation is doing. And nowadays we work a lot with exchanging Python snippets. We have the files from the tutorials. People start from the tutorials, put things together. But people have to put things together, a time stepping and a mixed formulation from here. An advanced Navier-Stokes method, as we see later on in the day. And putting these things together requires still some deep knowledge of things. Maybe it's still a lot you have to combine. They're getting it run optimally, combining with a preconditioner. You have seen yesterday you have a lot of possibilities, but maybe not everyone wants to have go into the details with elasticity and into the details with Navier-Stokes. So the model templates are an idea to wrap the details into a model, the model elasticity, Navier-Stokes. Okay, on top of ng-solve. So we're still importing all the ng-solve stuff, what we have seen yesterday. And from the model template, NGS templates, we are importing an elasticity model, a Navier-Stokes model, some equations which are now available. I should not forget to execute all cells, otherwise I will crash somewhere during the presentation, and it usually happens in my trainings. Okay. It's a GUI app. Let's do an elasticity model. It should be very simple. Okay, defining a geometry, mesh it. The geometry from simple description as we had yesterday, having a mesh. The geometry knows the boundary region, bottom right, top left. And instead, right, defining the space, writing down the Bayesian formulation, we say, okay, we want to have an elasticity model. On this, living on this mesh, having a material law, it can be a hook material with a Young modulus and Poisson ratio. On the boundary region called left, we want to have Dirichlet, we want to have a boundary form for us on the right. We want to do a geometric nonlinear simulation, give some discretization parameter, fourth order, and solve it. And the model has a grid function. It's called displacement. We can access it and draw the displacement as we have seen yesterday, as we would have set up the displacement grid function. And it also does the post-processing. It computes the strains and stresses. For example, we want to look at the XX Kirchhoff stress. We can draw it, and we see it. Very similar as you have seen yesterday. Okay, you can set some verbosity level. If you get more verbosities, then we see how it does the Newton iterations. Okay, it doesn't look very nice here in the slide mode, but you can do a bit the verbosity level. Oops. Okay. We've seen Dirichlet boundary conditions, displacement boundary conditions are a bit more painful. You have to set something. Okay, it's the same example, elasticity. Now we want to set boundary displacements. Let's say on the left, boundary called left, zero. On the boundary called right, displacement in displacement right. Displacement right should be a parameter set to zero initially. And this parameter we can change later on, so we can parameterize the force. What I'm doing here is some load stepping, or increasing the displacement. I set the parameter, I increment the parameter by dot one in every step. And solve the model again. So I can do this now. Okay, so I adjust shearing the component and moving the right side up. And I can do this a couple of times, moving up. I think it's a level how it's usable for application engineers. So it's a higher level. You don't want to go into the details of the variational formulation. It still gives you the flexibility of Python. You can play with the parameters. Okay, you can add a GUI on top of it where you have a slide where you move the displacement on the right or scale the force. Okay, yeah.
So, I mean, I use Salome, for instance, to check the boundaries. Can one do this with ng-solve? So what you have
done... Wait a second. Wait, next slide. Okay, next slide. Here we are importing a universal file, which was generated by, which comes from an step file, meshed by Salome, and we import the universal file from Salome, including the boundary conditions, boundary condition levels. I think this was the question. Okay, so we prepared a universal file meshed by Salome. I think if the version just uploaded, it downloads the file from a cloud drive. Okay, import this. Okay, here's still the long time old NetGen GUI. You can click on faces. There is something like edit boundary conditions. Here we can expect boundary names. You see this face here is called right, this face here is called left. This is default. So these boundary conditions are coming from Salome nah. Okay, execute this. Okay, very similar with the final elasticity problem. Linear material, hook material now. Boundary force at the right. One in z direction, left minus one. We have Dirichlet, homogeneous Dirichlet boundary condition at the holes. Running it. It should take about 20 seconds. Preparing the preconditioner, iterating. Sorry, it does not fit. About 20 iterations. The solution. And we see the Mises stresses. Go to 20. Okay, something we expect. Okay, not only for the small unit square, but also for including larger models, including the mesh file from external cut tool like Salome or as you like. Okay, Navier-Stokes. Okay, define the geometry, rectangle with a circle, or import the mesh from somewhere. Mesh it. This channel with a hole. Okay, let's take a Navier-Stokes model, viscosity, fix the time step, so it's still on the level that you specify in the time step. You say what is at the inflow boundary, what is your inflow profile, using ng-solve syntax, a vector value coefficient function, initialize it. This absolute value of the velocity. Okay, at this point I have to tell you some truth. There is a new flag reset is true, so we are resetting the GUI. Otherwise, in your case, it might crash now frequently since the GUI still wants to plot the old fields and the not taking care of the new one. This is a new flag which came in the last night release. Okay, having the time loop here. Every time step we do a time step, asking the Navier-Stokes solver to do a time step. And execute this. Okay. Okay, so the stopping was from the event loop from the two-byte, which was fixed very recently on the Mac by Matthias, but still from time to time we have slight steps. Okay, very easy, set up a time step and ask the model to do a time step with some time stepping method inside program by experts. Transport equations. Okay, you have the convection equation, transport equation. You give some initial condition, you give a wind, how you want to transport your initial condition. Transport equation, you set the wind, this vector field going as a circle. So we have set the initial condition, this Gaussian peak here, and run time steps like this, and yeah. Okay. So it's doing some higher order Runge-Kutta method for with explicit time stepping methods for the transport equation. Very much the details you have seen yesterday in the presentation by Christoph Lernfeld. Now just say transport equation, give a wind, and do stepping. Convection diffusion. You want to have a convection diffusion model, you mean have you have some diffusion coefficient, a wind again, doing the splitting method, hybrid DG, implicit for the diffusion, explicit for the transport, very similar. Oops, forgot to execute this, analysis. This is a diffusion, let's say, peak diffuse. Okay, some natural convection. You have now a Stokes equation coupled to a convection diffusion equation. So the change of temperature changes the density of the medium, leads to gravitational forces. With the velocity, you transport temperature. So it's a two-way coupled, weakly coupled equation between Navier-Stokes and convection diffusion equations. This is really Benard benchmark example. Okay, it's a rectangle here. Okay, and one page to set up a Navier-Stokes model. And this rectangle, you give some coefficients from the benchmark. You have a convection diffusion equation where the wind. The wind for the convection diffusion equation is coming now as a solution from the Navier-Stokes equation. You take the velocity of the Navier-Stokes equation as the wind for the convection diffusion. You can give any coefficient function, and what the Navier-Stokes model is giving you is a coefficient function for the velocity. And you need the change of temperature, change of density, as a force term for Navier-Stokes. So we can add this force term from the convection diffusion equation. You access the solution as dot concentration. And you can give this as force to the Navier-Stokes. So you have to define first one model and then the other, and you have to give the solution of the second one now as the right-hand side to the first one. Okay, what we have. So we have some random initial condition. It's asking for an input, so I have to press some key here. Oops, yeah, genau. So we're looking here at the temperature. We can look at the velocity. That's a function of velocity with surface vectors. Okay, so this benchmark produces the 7 vortices. We're looking at the absolute velocity of the velocity, seeing the velocity, reaching back to temperature. Oops. Sorry, I don't see temperature. Okay, so the velocity is moving the hot fluid up. You see the temperature is going up, so if the medium, the fluid is lighter there, so it causes more upward driving forces, and it's a self-coupling process, and it stabilizes due to the viscosity. Okay, so the vision is to be able to couple these models together, have a Navier-Stokes model, have a convection diffusion equation, and here we have a very simple coupling of this weakly coupled problem to the time step simultaneously. And the model does the time step whatever thinks it's best for the model. Okay, this is the way how we use it. Let's have also a look inside. There are just a few Python scripts. Want to have a look into elasticity. If the material loads a hook material, a neo-hook material, you give the energy density, which you can use as a variation, but for the post-processing, you also provide the strain, computing the stress. In the elasticity, here's the documentation comes in, you have a few parameters, linear, non-linear geometric, what are the forces, we are checking what boundary forces you are providing. If they are linear or nonlinear, in nonlinear case we have the variation of the Cauchy-Green strain tensor and energy of depending on Cauchy-Green. If they solve, then we are calling the prepared linear or nonlinear solvers, for example, calling the Newton method. When working on the model templates, I also realized that we need some more consistency in the solvers of this kind, like the solvers dot boundary value problem, which was now very quick hack. But if you use it repeatedly, you quickly learn that it's not completely consistent, and you need some more parameters for them. And you can access some results, some derived quantities like the strain, linear, nonlinear strain. You can access the stress depending on the primal variable. Convection diffusion is pretty much as in the tutorial from Christoph yesterday. You define a diffusion, you define by HDG, you define the convection with DG. At the MATS level, it's quite complicated here, but to learn this, I think the tutorials from yesterday are very useful. You see how the discretization is coming up. You can see the components in the iTutorials, and here many things are put together. This is a Navier-Stokes solver using the simple method, simple pressure correction, time stepping, with quite some advanced discretization using a mixed formulation with the stress tensors, symmetric stress tensors. We do a local colonization with hidden DOFs to reduce the memory effort. This gives us a hybrid mixed discretization of the A block for the Stokes. Here we have several versions of the convection operator. Let me just briefly sketch this. Okay, so the velocity is in HDiff. For a more efficient evaluation, we transfer the HDiff variable to Piola transformed vector L2, to the DG with the vector L2 variables, convert back, having the operator notation here to make it very compact, which allows us to define a convection operator in either of these advanced methods. Do a mixed problem for the Poisson projection. Doing this, the projector here, in a CG solver with static condensation and maybe an H1, AMG for the coupling types, the time step with the M star matrix and the projection. Okay, so just to look inside once, so it's quite technical, but it's not extremely long. And if you're working in the field of mixed methods for Navier-Stokes, you recognize the terms here. If you're not working, don't worry too much about this. So the files are not too complicated for the experts working in this area. Okay, there's a lot of ongoing work. We design them now to have some more or less unified interface, how to access the model templates and also how to access the solvers from the model templates. Newton give also the way of how to call iterative solvers from the Newton methods. Yeah. Michael Neunteufel has a lot of contributions. Late in the afternoon, you see how to run EdgeSolve and Spider, also integrating these model templates in the GUI. Christopher Lackner will talk about this more in the afternoon. People have been asking, how do you do ILA, Lagrangian-Eulerian formulation. We can deform the meshes with grid functions also to do fluid structure interaction with waving elastic structures. Michael will talk about this in the afternoon. Okay, now everything was running as a notebook, but it would be great to have everything also running in MPI parallel in very unified fashion. Not complete, but not too much missing. Lucas will talk in the afternoon how to do the solvers in MPI parallel, also calling PETSI solvers, how to build up what is needed, or how much do you have to understand to run it in MPI parallel. Some matrix operators need some fine-tuning. Also the exercise tomorrow with Lucas will teach on how to set up things in parallel. Also feasible, would be great, not yet working, but to have the model compute shape derivatives automatically from the model to do automatic shape optimization with it. We have the next session with Peter and Kevin on doing shape optimization with ng-solve on a mainly automatic level, but this can be also brought into these models. Okay, maybe also a question. Okay, now we have put it together in a fairly few internal tests, but of course the more people try it, the more questions appear. Can you do this, or why can't we do that, or why is it not natural as I expected? Maybe just try it out and let us know what you can use, what are missing features. Some of them are very easy to add. I'm also a bit conservative in adding features, so I want to have always reusable features, so it's always a decision how specific wishes are and how general they are. If you miss something, also maybe you, if you are on a level, if you like to do it, also think how to implement these missing features. And what we definitely need to have to more contact with field experts, so we like to cooperate in research. We are university, we are a research team. On one side, on numerical methods, like solvers, how to do saddle point solvers faster, how to do preconditioners there, how to do parallel preconditioning better. Time stepping is not our core topics, but my go to time stepping, splitting methods, maybe also space time, so the which is to have it coupled also higher order in time with some version of space-time methods, do the optimization on top, and also the cooperation on research and applications. I have to say that often edge solve development was not only driven by the idea of doing a method, but also from the need in can I solve this problem, and then things have been developed for problems for applications like in electromagnetics. And if you come with some application, we may also think how to extend models, how to add additional models. Let's see how it will develop.